Welcome back to the course on power quality. This is Dr. Prema bringing you the course on power quality provided by VTU eShikshana. So we are in the fourth module of the course power quality. We are going to see the third lecture of module 4. Module 4 is on applied harmonics, and in the last two lectures of module 4 we have seen the point of common coupling, the concept of point of common coupling, and then the evaluation of harmonic distortion, how to control the harmonics, and where to control the harmonics. So these were the topics covered in the last two lectures. So here today we are going to see the third lecture, which is going to deal with harmonic studies in the power quality. So in this lecture we will be describing the procedure for harmonic study, and we are also going to identify the methods to develop a system model for the harmonic study, and various methods to model the harmonic sources, and also we are going to enlist the various computer tools available for the study of harmonics. So these are the topics to be covered in this lecture. Now coming to the harmonic studies, why do we require harmonic studies? This harmonic studies play an important role in the characterizing and understanding the extent of harmonic problems. So suppose if you have, we are experiencing any problem in an industry or in a utility side, if you are experiencing a problem, first we need to identify or characterize the extent or the severity of that problem. And harmonic studies are often performed when we are going to find a solution to an existing harmonic problem. Already we are experiencing a problem, and then we need to know more about the problem, and we need to know how we are going to solve the problem. So in such cases, we need to do the harmonic study. And the next case is installing a large capacitor bank on the utility distribution system or industrial power system. Suppose if you are doing, we all know the effect of capacitor bank. In case if you have a nonlinear load in the system, and also if you have a capacitor bank, there can be problems of resonance. So if we are going to install a large capacitor bank on the distribution system or an industrial power system, then we need to know or we need to study about the harmonics. And the next case is when we are going to install a large nonlinear device or load. It could be in a new industrial plant, or it could be in an existing industrial plant. In case if you are updating an industrial plant with another set of nonlinear loads such as speed rise, then we need to study the harmonics in it. Then the next case is when we are going to design a harmonic filter. In case we already have a problem with us, and then if you are going to have a solution of installing a harmonic filter, before installing the filter, we need to study the effect of the filter with, when it will be installed. And also the last case is when we are going to convert a capacitor bank to a harmonic filter. See, most of the times the capacitor banks in the system can itself act as a harmonic filter. So in case if you are going to use a capacitor bank or a power factor improvement capacitor as a harmonic filter, in such case also we need to study about the harmonic. So these are the various scenarios in which we are going to study harmonic in detail and to get a solution for it. So basically, harmonic studies provide a means to evaluate various problem solution or various problems, and to evaluate possible solutions for that problem, and also to find their effectiveness under a wide range of conditions. So when we are solving the problem, we need to test the cases for all worst case scenarios. So under various conditions, we need to test it, and we need to see the effectiveness of that solution under various circumstances that will lead to a final solution. So this is about harmonic studies. So here, what are we going to do? We are going to see what are the cases by which we need to do the harmonic study, and what is the procedure by which we are going to do the harmonic study, and also how we are going to proceeded, whether we are going to do a simulation, or if we are going to do a simulation, whether we are going to do a manual simulation or a computerized simulation. So all these things we are going to study in this particular lecture. So now, coming to the harmonic study, when we are doing the study of harmonics, there should be a systematic way in which we are going to study it, or there should be a systematic procedure by which we are going to do this harmonic study. So the ideal procedure for performing a power system harmonic study will be summarized here. We are going to do step by step. So the first step is to determine the objective of the study. So what exactly is the objective? Why are we going to do this harmonic study? So in the previous slide, the first slide, we have seen the scenarios in which we need to do the harmonic study. So we are going to, the first step in the harmonic study is to identify the objective. This is very important. It is important to know the exact reason for the study. Why are we going to do the study? So that is the first procedure. Now, if you are taking an example, your objective might be to identify what is causing an existing problem. If there is an existing problem, you need to identify what exactly is the cause for that problem. That may be your objective. Another objective may be to determine if a new plant expansion which contains a newer equipment, and if they are nonlinear loads such as adjustable speed drives, and whether or if you are having a new capacitor, whether they are feasible. If you are doing that, in case if you are installing that, what could be the problems which arise due to that? So that is an objective. So whatever it is, first we need to identify the objective of the study. And the next step in the procedure is to see whether the system is complex or not. If the system is complex, then you need to perform a computer simulation. We need to perform a pre-measurement computer simulation. That could be based on the best information available. So in case if you have the data available, you can use that. Or if you are, the best thing is to get the measured data. So if there is a possibility of taking the measurement, then we can take the measured data and we can process it using a computer simulation. Now, in absence of any measured data, generally the measurements are expensive in terms of labor, equipment, and it can even cause possible disruption of the plant operation. So due to that, we cannot always depend on the measured data. So generally it will be economical to have a good idea about the system, and if you have any data available, you can process with that data. So that is the next step. So that means if you have to see whether the system is very complex. If it is complex, and we need to have a computer simulation for that. Now the next step in the procedure is to make measurement of the existing harmonic conditions. So first you need to study the existing harmonic conditions and take a measurement. By how do we do this? We can do this by characterizing the sources of harmonic current and also the system bus voltage distortion. So we can see the distortions in the system bus. Also we can characterize or model the harmonic sources, the existing harmonic sources, and by which we can see the condition, how much is the harmonic there in the system, and then we will know what to do further. And the next step is to calibrate the computer model using measurements. So once we have done the computer model, so the computer model will have the system, the computer model of the system and the harmonic sources in it, and when we simulate, we should be able to identify the extent of harmonic current or the extent of voltage distortion in the system. Now, once we have done that, then the next step is to calibrate the computer model using measurements. And then we need to study the new circuit conditions for the existing problem. And the last step will be to develop solution. So once we have completely studied how much is the harmonic present in it, and what are the system parameters which are getting affected with that, then the next step is to develop solutions. So what are the solutions? In the last lecture, we have seen some of the solutions such as filter or a capacitive bank or a line choke, etc. So we can decide on any of the possible solutions. And then once we get the solution, we can check whether it can the feasibility of that by checking it, whether it can give the solution or not. Once we have the exact model of the system and the sources and the solution, it is possible by simulation to know whether it is feasible for the existing system or not. Also, we need to check the sensitivity of the results to important variables. So what are the system variables? And we need to see how proposed system is sensible to the system parameters, how it is going to affect the system parameters. So this is the complete procedure of a harmonic study. Now the main steps which we have in the harmonic study is first to know the system, then we need to develop a simulation model for the system, and we need to incorporate all the harmonic sources. That means we need to model the harmonic sources and we need to incorporate it in the system, and then we need to analyze it. Once we analyze, once we know what is the problem, exact problem, how much we have to mitigate, then we need to get a possible solution. So this is the complete procedure by which we are going to exhibit a harmonic study. So in this, the two important things are first to develop a system model and to develop a model for the harmonic source. Now next, we are going to see how we are going to develop a system model and how we are going to develop a harmonic source, or how we are modeling a harmonic source. So the next one is to develop a system model. Now there are two fundamental issues which need to be considered when we are developing a system model for harmonic studies. The first issue is the extent of the system model to be included in the simulation. So what does it mean? How much of the system we need to include in the simulation? That is one first question or first issue we need to be addressed. Now the second one is one should decide whether the model should be represented as a single phase equivalent or a three phase equivalent. Now if you are taking an example, suppose if the utility is planning to install a very large capacitive bank, where it is not there, the utility is planning to install a very large capacitive bank on a distribution feeder. Suppose, so what do we need here? We have a capacitive bank which is going to be installed in a distribution feeder. So what is the system here? Our system is the distribution feeder. And if the capacitor is installed, we need to evaluate the frequency response associated with the bank. Now, when we are thinking of the system, the distribution feeder, it is totally impractical to represent the entire distribution system in the simulation model. We need not do that. So what generally we do, one approach will be to start developing a model, one or two buses back from the bus of interest. So you will not develop the complete distribution feeder model. We will take only the last two, three buses, one or two buses back from the bus of our interest. And then what we have to do, we have to include all the details in that system with those two. So we will see how we are going to do in detail. And that is the first approach. So instead of representing the entire distribution system, we will take only one or two. And another approach is to start with a simple circuit which accurately represents the phenomena. What is that? We are going to install a capacitor bank, right? So one simple circuit accurately represents the phenomena. And after that, once you have that simple circuit, add more of the system details to that particular circuit and determine the impact of the solution result. So this is the first. This is what we are going to do. So the main two problems we are going to address are the extent of the system model. How much the system, suppose if you take the example of the distribution system, how much of the distribution system we need to add or we need to model in order to represent the problem completely. And the second issue is to whether to represent this in a single phase or a three phase model. Then now we are going to see the let us see each issue separately. First, let us take the how much the system model we need to build. So when we are going to model the distribution system for harmonic studies, it is usually sufficient to represent the up. So when we have a distribution system, we will have the upstream system, which will contain the entire transmission system from that to the power station, right? So that is called the upstream transmission system. So generally, it is easier or it is sufficient to represent the upstream transmission system with a short circuit equivalent at the high voltage side of the substation transformer. So we have a substation, and high voltage will be represented with the entire transmission system with a short circuit equivalent. Generally, we will take the Thevenin's equivalent of that and do it. So what happens? We have a very big transmission system, which we are going to represent with a short circuit model. So in that case, the leakage impedance of the transformer will be much more than the short circuit equivalent. And this will effectively isolate the transmission and the distribution system. And in case if you have, so this is the case if you have a transmission system in the upstream. In case if we have a capacitor bank on the high voltage side, then that capacitor bank has to be modeled separately. Why is that required? Because the capacitor bank can have a significant effect such as resonant condition. So that we need to model separately. So if there is no capacitor bank on the upstream, you can just represent it by the short circuit equivalent model. Otherwise, if you have a capacitor bank, we need to model that capacitor bank on the high voltage side. Anyway, if there is a capacitor bank near the high voltage side of the transformer, then part of the transmission system has to be modeled, which will include the capacitor bank. So the combination of the transformer and the capacitor bank will have can behave as a filter, because the transformer has a leakage inductance, and that and a capacitor bank on the high voltage side can act as a filter for some frequency. That is why that has to be modeled separately. So we have to model it, and we have to see whether this will work as a filter for some particular frequency as seen from the low voltage side of the transformer. So that is the case with upstream transmission. Now, when we are taking the downstream transmission system, that means on the low voltage side of the distribution transformer, then we need to consider many components, most of the components which are there in that, such as the feeder line, the capacitor bank, key service transformers, the end user capacitor bank. All these need to be represented separately using a system model. However, so generally what we do, if you have overhead transmission system, we need not consider it the equivalent capacitance of that. But if you have an underground cable, if you have a significant amount of underground cable, then that has to be represented. The cable capacitance has to be represented in the system, especially if the study is concerned with higher order harmonic. If it is concerned with higher order harmonic, then the capacitance of the underground cable will affect significantly. So apart from the other components like feeder lines, capacitor banks, key service transformer, end user capacitor banks, we need to model the underground cable capacitance also in the system. We need to incorporate that also in the system, because that also can cause a significant impact on the high frequency or higher order harmonics in the system. So this is how we model the system. So basically, if you are trying to have a distribution system, we need not model it completely. we can only represent the Thevenin's equivalent circuit of the upstream in case if you don't have any capacitor bank. If you have a capacitor bank on the high voltage side, then you need to represent that separately or model that separately. On the downstream, you have to represent all the components in the system. So this is about the system modeling. Now, the second case or the second issue, which is whether we need to represent the system with a single phase model or a three phase model. Generally, a single phase equivalent model is much simpler and less complicated to develop compared to a three phase model. So it is always preferable to develop a single phase model than a three phase model. But it is most of the time or sometimes it is inadequate to analyze unbalanced phenomena. If you have an unbalanced phenomena in the system or if you have many number of single phase loads in the system, then you cannot represent it using a single phase equivalent model. That time you will have to go for a three phase equivalent model. So when you have a three phase equivalent model, then you need to have positive sequence, negative sequence and zero sequence separately. So that will be slightly complicated than the single phase equivalent model. But fortunately, we have a rule which permits the simplified positive sequence modeling for many three phase industrial loads. And why positive sequence modeling? Because determining the response of the system to positive sequence harmonics is almost straightforward. As the utility and industrial power engineers are used to doing such modeling. We are almost used to doing the positive sequence modeling, so it is easier and straightforward to do the positive sequence modeling. So we have a rule when we need to do the positive sequence modeling and when we need to consider zero sequence. What is that rule? It is written here. That is, the rule states that when there is a delta winding in the transformer anywhere in series with the harmonic source and the power system, only positive sequence need to be represented to determine the system response. It is impossible for the zero sequence harmonics to be present because they are blocked. So what does it mean? It means that if you have a delta winding transformer anywhere in the system, then we need not take zero sequence because we know that the zero sequence current is trapped in the delta connection, in the delta winding, right? Because it cannot go out. Only with the neutral connected star connected winding, you have the zero sequence current flowing through the neutral. If it is a delta connection, then it is a trapped one. So if there is any transformer delta connection in any of the part of the system, then we need not consider the zero sequence current. We can only model positive. So there is one figure which represents this. So in this, you can see that how the transformer connection is affecting the system model. So we can see that it, the source side, we have a transformer, which is delta star. Also on the distribution side, we have one transformer which is delta delta. So the transformer which is the source one, which is delta star, and the distribution side where we have delta delta, we can straight away model it using positive sequence. And if there is any negative sequence, that also, because zero sequence will be absent in the case of a delta connection. Now, the second one, even though we have a delta, what happens? There are many single phase nonlinear loads present in the system. So for such cases, a three phase model is required. So we need not do the three phase modeling of the entire system. We need to do only where we have several single phase loads. Or in case if you have some unbalanced phenomena, then you need to model three phase. Otherwise, if you have a delta transformer, then zero sequence will be absent. You can only do it with the positive sequence and the negative sequence modeling itself. Okay, so what did we see here? We saw how we can model the system. If you have a distribution system, how to model it, or to what extent we need to take the system model, whether we need to do the entire system or only a part of the system. If you are doing a part of the system, how we have to do that. Also, we saw whether we have to, when we have to choose a three-phase model, when we have to choose a single-phase model. Okay, I hope that point is clear. Now, next, we are going to the modeling of harmonic sources. So far, we have seen the modeling of only the system. Now, we are going to see how we can model the harmonic sources in the system. So, we know that all the harmonic sources are nonlinear elements in the system. And all the harmonic sources, which are nonlinear elements, they are generally considered to be injection sources into the linear network model. So they are injecting the harmonic. Most of the nonlinear loads are injecting the harmonic current into the system, right? So because of that reason, we can represent that as a current injection sources or a voltage source, because they are injecting the harmonic currents into the system. So in the figure, you can see the two same diagram which are represented. So in the first one line diagram, we can see that we have a source, the line, and then we have a nonlinear load at the end, right? Now that nonlinear load can be replaced by a current source, because it is injecting the harmonic current to the system. So we are interested only in the harmonic current which is produced by the nonlinear system, right, in harmonic studies. So it is not required to model the system completely, because most of these nonlinear loads are power electronic converters, and it is always not possible to completely model the power electronic converter, because there will be many power electronic sources which have different modeling, right? So we need not do that. We can represent that as a harmonic injection current source or a voltage source. In most of the harmonic studies, it is enough to treat all the harmonic sources together as one current source. So you can convert all the power electronic converters using an equivalent circuit. The voltage distortion at the service bus will be generally very low. Generally, it will be less than 5%. Therefore, the current distortion for many nonlinear loads will be relatively constant, and it will be independent of the distortion of the supply system. So we need to only represent the nonlinear load as a current source. So that is the way we generally model the harmonic source. We need not model element by element. We can overall represent it as a current source. Now, the values of the injector current should be determined by measurement. So, how much the current is produced by the harmonic source? We cannot always get the data. So, it has to be done by measurement. So, in case if you don't have a measurement or a published data, we can assume that the harmonic current is inversely proportional to the harmonic number. So why do we do that? We assume that generally we have a square wave. So if you have a square wave, and if you do the harmonic analysis of the square wave, we get the harmonic voltages as the product of the fundamental voltage and the, or it is proportional to the harmonic number. Suppose if you are taking a fifth harmonic current or fifth harmonic voltage, that fifth harmonic voltage will be the fundamental voltage divided by the number 5, because we are measuring the fifth harmonic. So we can say that generally it is inversely proportional to the harmonic number. This is by taking the assumption that we have a square wave. But most of the modern power electronic equipment does not have a square wave, because if you are having a PWM technique, you are altering the shape of the waveform, or it is not a square wave. In such cases, we cannot take always as the voltage is proportional to the, or inversely proportional to the harmonic number. So you have a table here, and it is showing how much will be the harmonic component in case of if you have different type of loads. So for example, if you read the table for the 6-pulse adjustable P drive, for the first harmonic, if your current is 100, then for generally the triplet harmonics will be absent for 3 days, and if the fifth harmonic will be 18. Ideally speaking, if it is a fifth harmonic, it has to be 1/5, right? It has to be 20, but for an adjustable speed drive, it is going to be 18. And if you take a PWM drive, it is going to be much higher than that, it is 90. And if you take an arc lighting, you can expect third harmonic also. Triplet harmonics are not absent. Only in the case of three-phase loads or three-phase converter, you will have a triplet harmonics absent. So otherwise, if you take arc lighting, the third harmonic is 20, 57, and then it goes lesser. But if you take a PWM drive, you can see from the table that if the fundamental component is 100, it is why we give 100, because we are representing as a percentage. Then 90% will be present in the fifth harmonic, 80 on the seventh, 75% on 11th, and 13%. It is quietly higher, right? Now, if you take the example of an SMPS, switch mode power supply, then you will have all the harmonics present. Third harmonic is 70%, fifth is 40, seventh is 15, 97, etc. So it goes on reducing, but always it is not inversely proportional. Most of the advanced power converters will have something different. So you can have a standard data available. See, from this table, you can take this as a lookup table and take that approximately the harmonic current and model the source. Okay. In case if you don't have a measurement, if you have a measurement, that is best, you can take the measurement. And why do we require that? We need to represent the nonlinear source as a current source as shown in the diagram. And we need to give the how much harmonics are present in that, how much will be the harmonic current, right? So for that we need it. If you have measurement, we can take it straight away. If you don't have measurement, then we can take any standard table like this to get the harmonic current. Now, this represents as a separate scenario where we have a condition of resonance. See, earlier case, we have modeled the harmonic source. Considering that, there is no resonance, right? Now, in case if you have a capacitor bank along with the nonlinear load, then there can be a possibility of resonance. So when the system is near resonance, a simple current source model will not be suitable. What will happen there? It will give an excessively high prediction of the voltage distortion. So when you have a parallel resonance, the system impedance is going to be very high, right? So what happens? The model is actually trying to inject a constant current into a very high impedance, which is not a valid representation in reality. In reality, it is not so, because when we have resonance, we have very high impedance, right? But if you are representing it with a constant harmonic current source, which will not be correct. So in such cases, what we do? In such cases, we cannot represent it as a constant current source. Instead, we need to represent it either as a Thevenin equivalent model or a Norton equivalent model. That is the most commonly used, or it can be the accurate model in case if you have resonant, or in case if you have a capacitor bank with it, there can be a possibility of resonance. So at that time, you cannot represent the harmonic sources as a constant current source. So what we do here, we will be taking either the Thevenin's equivalent or the Norton equivalent model of the system. So this is about modeling the harmonic sources in the system. So what did we see? We will just have a quick recap on what we have seen today. We started with harmonic studies. So what are the requirements? When are we going to do the harmonic study? So we saw several scenarios by which we do the harmonic studies. And then if you are doing the harmonic studies, you should have a systematic approach to that. What is the procedure for doing the harmonic study? So mainly the procedure include, we have to see whether the complexity of the system. If the system is complex, we need to do a computer simulation. And if you are doing a computer simulation, we need to model the system and we need to model the harmonic sources separately, right? When we are modeling the system, in case if you are modeling a distribution system, we need not model the complete distribution system. We can take only the part where we are concerned with, and also we represent the other part of the system by equivalent, short circuit equivalent model. So when you are modeling the harmonic sources, generally it is a general practice to model the harmonic sources using a constant harmonic current. In case of resonance, then you will have to represent using a Thevenin or Norton equivalent circuit. So this is what we have seen today. And in the next lecture, we will start with the computer tools which are used for harmonic studies. Thank you.